Well, Oil Country is celebrating Sweet 16 as the Edmonton Oilers head into their All-Star break. Welcome to the panel presented by Sportsnet. Lots to talk about. That's why we lean on two of the very best in this business, Jack Michaels and Bob Stauffer to my left. And, of course, the headline coming into Saturday afternoon's matchup against the Nashville Predators, Bob, was Corey Perry making his Oilers debut. Bob, if you want to break down what you saw from Perry on Saturday afternoon, and then Jack, you can follow up with what his presence means in that Oilers dressing room. Bob?
Well, I mean, I think Corey Perry came as advertised. I mean, it wasn't the type of game where maybe some of the gamesmanship that we might see come playoff time might be required. Maybe the type of gamesmanship we might see on Tuesday in Vegas might be required. But the reality of the situation is he's still got real good hands. He'd be the first to tell you, he's a first-line player for a number of years. Maybe he doesn't have the pace to consistently play up there, but he played with two guys that can really skate, but he can still think and process the game at that level. He made a couple plays today that were just unreal. And it shows you Oilers fans are totally engaged in it. They wanted to see him be successful. He made some plays that I think really intrigued a lot of people out there with what he could do.
First shift of the game, Corey Perry did what Corey Perry does best, and that's agitate the opposing team's netminder. He got right in there. Two guys had to take him out, and that's what Corey Perry is going to do for you. He makes his living in that office, that 6-foot radius, and that gives the Oilers another consistent net front presence with skill in and around the net, of course, joining Zach Hyman. And the other thing Corey Perry does is I think he wanted to feel that. I think he wanted to feel that contact right away. He hadn't played a game since November the 19th, and he wants to feel guys on him. He's anything but a perimeter player. So that initial contact, I think, drove him into the game. Bob makes a good point. One of the reasons I think Chris Knobloch put Perry with Holloway and McLeod is he wanted Perry to feel like he instantly had to be at full game speed. And with those, young legs, and I thought they were terrific today. Bob mentioned during one of the Sportsnet panels, and he's right, that as they learn to play together, some of the plays that just missed in the win over Nashville will start clicking. And I think as each feels one another out, and there was a play where Perry was behind the defense and Holloway couldn't get it to him, and there was another play where Perry made a beautiful short side delivery and Holloway just wasn't quite there, that'll start clicking the more they play with one another. We were told that Corey Perry actually asked a little bit about Dylan Holloway's game, so he's already invested in his new club.
Yeah, I know a lot of people bring up Corey Perry's playoff resume. He has 124 Stanley Cup playoff points. That currently ranks 59th all time. Pretty remarkable when you consider all the players that have come through the league, all the playoff performances we have seen, and 196 playoff games to his name as well. Four more will make him the 22nd player all time to achieve.
But it's the recent history that matters, in
exactly,
my opinion.
Exactly.
He's been productive recently.
I even liked, with that line, Jack, I even liked the start of the third period, because Forsberg was unreal tonight. I mean, that was
best game I've ever seen.
He was fantastic, and their line dominated play 5-on-5, and McLeod and Holloway and Perry, that line matched up the best against that top line for Nashville.
This afternoon marked the 14th straight hockey game that the Oilers allowed two goals or less. Jack, what are you seeing from this Oilers club that's allowing them to see so much success on the defensive front?
Well, I think as compared to earlier in the year, and Edmonton played Nashville twice, and they won 6-1 and lost 5-2, and Bob, I think you'd agree with me, I'm not sure they gave up any fewer chances in the 6-1 win than they did in the 5-2 loss.
40 shots against them.
Yeah, and Jack Campbell, that was his best game of the year, NHL or AHL. He was very good that night, and he had to be, because early in the season, the Oilers were doing two things. Number one, they were allowing everyone to go down Main Street. The middle of the ice was wide open in their own zone for much of the first month of the season. And the other thing is they were giving up 1-2-on-1 after another. The rush chances against were out of control. And as a result, even though the shot clock didn't look that bad, the quality of chances, I really think, put a damper on some early season confidence for both Jack Campbell and Stuart Skinner. So they've cleaned that up. And now Stuart Skinner knows where the shots are coming from. He trusts his teammates, who trust him to make the save that he needs to make. And Skinner, along with Calvin Pickard, who has been a valuable addition both on the ice and off the ice, a perfect complement and a perfect personality to fit in with this particular group, where so much pressure is on the top players to finally get over the hump and win a Stanley Cup. I think they've got a nice nice blend there. It starts with goaltending, cleaning up some of the combinations on the PK. Chris Knobloch has come in and kind of calmed that down a little bit. Yeah. The guys know who are going to go over the boards first, second, and third on the PK, and as a result, what is it, 38 out of 39? I mean, it's on a tremendous roll.
Yeah, the numbers are ridiculous. I mean, you take a look at it when the coaching change was made, Edmonton was 30th in the league in goals against. They were 30th in the league in penalty killing. Since Chris Knobloch became the head coach with Paul Coffey and Mark Stewart taking over that PK, the Oilers have had the best penalty killing in the NHL. Obviously, your goalie needs to be your best penalty killer, but they still have the best penalty killing in the NHL. And goals, so they're number one in PK, and they're number two in goals against since Knobloch's been the head coach. And that's part of the reason why they're 26-6 and why they're 24-3. I mean, 16-game, they got the tied for the second longest winning streak in NHL history. They also became the third team in NHL history with 24 wins in 27 games.
Well, the leaders are certainly leading here in oil country. And just to wrap up the panel presented by Sportsnet, I would love to get your guys' thoughts on Chris Knobloch, the empowerment that we always hear about in true effect right now for this Oilers squad. You guys have already talked at length about a guy like Dylan Holloway. What about guys like Warren Fogle and Ryan McLeod, who are now kind of really finding their own game at the NHL level?
Well, I think to some degree, Chris Knobloch understood that it was going to be a defensive team first that would pull this club out of its funk, and that secondarily, he would need to include more people in the procession. He wanted to bring the minutes down for not only Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl, but Ryan Nugent-Hopkins and Zach Hyman. And he'll sometimes comment, that's still a work in progress. He wants to get everyone involved. And when this team is most effective, they're able to, you know, roll over four lines. And that's true of any successful team. But I think what he's done more than anything else is just bring a calming influence and reinstilled a confidence within the playing group that, look, you're my guys. You're gonna carry this team one way or the other. I'm the coach, but I believe in you. I'm not going to try to make radical changes in your game. Yeah. You'll pull yourself out of it. I believe in you, so go play. And I think Paul Coffey has done the same thing for the defense. I think that subtle shift in putting the defensemen all together on the same side of the room has made a tremendous difference in the sense that, yes, it's created a team within a team, but it's also created some internal competition where the defense now knows that it's not just the offense that's going to carry this club to where it ultimately wants to go.
You know, when we flew back from Seattle and the Oilers had won a game convincingly 4-1, and on that Sunday morning, you know, news broke that Edmonton was making the change. I know a lot of people were, and that's established, Jay Woodcroft did a good job here. But at the end of the day, that was a courageous decision. And Jeff Jackson played a significant part in that decision. And he knew Chris Knobloch the best because his clients were the ones that prospered the most. And I'm not talking Connor McDavid and Erie. I'm talking Alex DeBrincat. I'm talking Connor Brown. I'm talking Warren Fogle. I'm talking Darren Radish. Guys like that. Some of those guys weren't supposed to be high-end players. Alex DeBrincat's making $9 million a year in the NHL now. So I think that there is a belief from Jeff knowing that Knobloch could make players better and he could grow them and he could find roles and develop. And I think we're seeing that come to fruition. I'm 100% with Jack. Obviously, Paul Coffey has empowered the defense to make plays. And we can, it's not, to me, it's not Ekholm and Bouchard. For me, the primary guy is Desharnais. You look at his puck skills, I'm no longer concerned. Like last year in the playoffs, I was concerned. I'm no longer concerned with him. He's really taken a massive step.
How about that ovation he got after that great play on the PK as well? I mean, I think all of oil country is appreciating the play of number 73, and they're certainly appreciating what's going on with this hockey club. Sweet 16 as we head into the All-Star break. Enjoy getting your tan on in Mexico. And Bob Stauffer, well, the man never stops grinding. You can hear him on the Oilers Radio Network 5 to 7.
It's not really work, man, just so you know. It's not really work. We talk hockey for a living. Toy department of life.
I was just about to say, toy department of life. This is the panel presented by Sportsnet.